Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Dan Novak. This program is aimed at English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English. Coming up on the program, Jonathan Evans reports on a new film about the Thai cave rescue in 2018. Faith Perlow answers a question from a listener about the difference between the words famous and popular. And we finish with a story from Edgar Allan Poe called The Cask of Amontillado. But first, in 2021, shooting incidents in the northwestern American city of Seattle, Washington, reached their highest level for the five-year period starting in 2017. Dominique Davis was inside a Seattle-area religious center one day in March 2021 when a man with a handgun started firing. It was during a meeting of Community Passageways, a group he started that works to stop gun violence. The gunman shot 19-year-old Omari Wallace several times before fleeing. Wallace was attending a program meant to turn young people away from violence and keep them out of prison. Wallace died from his wounds. Two more Seattle shootings followed that week. Davis heard that there were two rival groups whose fights had recently gotten worse. A leader of one of the groups said the only way the violence would stop would be if the groups had more distance between each other. So Davis got 16 young men from the two groups to leave the city. He paid them to stay away for 30 days and to work with therapists and counselors. Davis said that since returning to Seattle, all but three of the young men have faced no criminal charges. The unusual plan is an example of how community groups are looking for new ways to stop the increase in shootings over the past 2 years. It is called community violence intervention. The approach sends people with personal influence within a community to help those most likely to be involved in gun violence. Community violence intervention is not new, but interest in it is growing. The U.S. Congress recently passed a law aimed at reducing gun violence. It contains measures meant to keep guns away from dangerous people. Through the law, Congress will provide $250 million for community violence prevention. The administration of President Joe Biden has also told city and state governments to use federal pandemic aid money for violence intervention. Paying money to local organizations is different from usual methods for dealing with violence, by using police. Aaliyah Harvey Quinn is the director of Force Detroit. She compares violence intervention to how we prevent drunk driving with our friends, just intervening and snatching the keys aggressively and using our relationships to do so. In June, at the same church in South Seattle where a shooting took place, Davis invited members of local groups that tried to ease conflicts to the front of the room. The leaders were mostly black. They said their work is part of a long struggle for safety and justice and against racism. They talked about their methods with members of similar groups from Newark, New Jersey, and Baltimore, Maryland. The meeting was part of an 18-month program supported by the Biden administration. It was paid for by 12 organizations that give to people in need called charities. The Community Violence Intervention Collaborative began in June 2021. Its goal was to train and expand local organizations in 16 cities. So far, few large cities or states have answered the Biden administration's call to spend money on these programs. But cities have until 2024 to use funding from the $1.9 trillion aid law passed in 2021 to prevent the spread of COVID-19 and the economic damage the disease caused. People working in Seattle's gun violence intervention groups feel a growing urgency about their work. Marty Jackson is the director of the Seattle area group, the SE Network. "We totally know the rest of the city needs this kind of attention," Jackson said. "We need resources to replicate what we know for sure is working in these concentrated places." Jeffrey A. Butts is a researcher at John Jay College of Criminal Justice in New York. He said there is not enough research about the effectiveness of such intervention efforts. "They say, we started doing Program X here 2 years ago, and our shootings have gone down by 30%, Butts said. "But that's not evidence that the program resulted in that change." But the Biden administration says it hopes its new program can create more money for such efforts. "By bringing philanthropy, the federal government, and community intervention leaders together, it puts our country on a path to redefining public safety in this country and reducing gun violence," said Julie Rodriguez, a Biden administration advisor.
4 years ago, a group of 12 boys and their soccer coach were rescued from a cave in Thailand. Now, their story has been told by award-winning American filmmaker Ron Howard in his new film, 13 Lives. The children and their coach were exploring the Tham Luang Cave in northern Thailand's Chiang Rai in June 2018. Heavy rains flooded the cave and trapped them underground. They survived 9 days in a partly flooded area of the cave before being discovered by 2 British divers. But it took members of Thailand's Navy and international volunteers another 8 days to bring them to safety. 13 Lives recreates what happened inside the cave and above it on the ground during those 17 days. Volunteers, engineers, and soldiers removed millions of liters of water from the cave. They also drilled through rocks looking for openings to reach the boys. Howard spoke to Reuters at the film's first showing in London earlier this week. He said, "It's not just about the heroic divers. It really is an entire community and a country and a lot of countries ultimately participating and making something amazing come true." The film stars American Viggo Mortensen and Ireland's Colin Farrell as British divers Rick Stanton and John Valanthen. Australian actor Joel Edgerton plays the part of Harry Harris. Harris was brought on to help when possible ways to save the boys were running out. The Thai performers in the movie included professional and non-professional actors. Many of the young boys playing the members of the soccer team had no acting experience. Stanton, Valanthen, and members of the International Rescue Dive Team attended the London showing. They praised Howard's representation of the events. "I think it's good for people to know what happened. It's not a documentary, but it's pretty much true to life," Stanton said. 13 Lives will be released in a small number of U.S. and British theaters on July 29th. It will be released worldwide on the Amazon Prime video service on August 5th. I'm Jonathan Evans.
Hello. This week on Ask a Teacher, we will answer a question from Mohammad Reza from Iran about the difference between famous and popular. Dear VOA teachers, would you please let us know the difference between the words popular and famous, and how to use them in our day-to-day speech? Thanks, Mohammad Reza. Dear Mohammad Reza, thanks for writing to us and asking this question. Famous and popular are both adjectives. The words may seem similar, but their meanings are very different. Let's start with famous. Famous means known or recognized by many people. We often use the word when describing people. For example, movie actors, singers, and professional athletes can be described as famous. For example, Taylor Swift is a famous singer-songwriter. Some famous people are known to people around the world. Others may be famous in their home country. Places can be famous too. For example, the Eiffel Tower in France and the pyramids in Egypt are very famous. Now let's talk about popular. Popular means liked or enjoyed by many people. One way we use popular is to talk about trends like popular fashion or popular styles. For example, the bucket hat was a popular trend in the 1990s, and now younger generations are wearing it again today. We also use popular to talk about people. For example, there are popular students at school. These people are generally well-liked by people in their class. They are not famous, though. People outside of the school probably do not know who they are. Places can also be described as popular. If we describe a place as popular, we mean a lot of people like to go there. Famous and popular mean different things. Just because someone is popular does not mean the person is famous. And some famous people might not be especially popular. Let us compare these two examples. This restaurant is famous. In this example, we are saying that many people know about this restaurant. Maybe it has become known for a special kind of food it serves. Maybe it appeared on a television show. This restaurant is popular. In this example, we are saying that many people go to the restaurant. But it may just be the local population that knows about it. Please let us know if these examples and explanations have helped you, Mohammad Reza. What question do you have about American English? Send us an email at learningenglish@voanews.com. And that's Ask a Teacher. I'm Faith Perlow.
Our story today is called The Cask of Amontillado. It was written by Edgar Allan Poe. Here is Larry West with the story.
Fortunato and I both were members of very old and important Italian families. We used to play together when we were children. Fortunato was bigger, richer, and more handsome than I was. And he enjoyed making me look like a fool. He hurt my feelings 1,000 times during the years of my childhood. I never showed my anger, however, so he thought we were good friends. But I promised myself that one day I would punish Fortunato for his insults to me. Many years passed. Fortunato married a rich and beautiful woman who gave him sons. Deep in my heart, I hated him. But I never said or did anything that showed him how I really felt. When I smiled at him, he thought it was because we were friends. He did not know it was the thought of his death that made me smile. Everyone in our town respected Fortunato. Some men were afraid of him because he was so rich and powerful. He had a weak spot, however. He thought he was an excellent judge of wine. I also was an expert on wine. I spent a lot of money buying rare and costly wines. I stored the wines in the dark rooms under my family's palace. Our palace was one of the oldest buildings in the town. The Montresor family had lived in it for hundreds of years. We had buried our dead in the rooms under the palace. These tombs were quiet, dark places that no one but myself ever visited. Late one evening, during carnival season, I happened to meet Fortunato on the street. He was going home alone from a party. Fortunato was beautiful in his silk suit, made of many colors, yellow, green, purple, and red. On his head he wore an orange cap, covered with little silver bells. I could see he had been drinking too much wine. He threw his arms around me. He said he was glad to see me. I said I was glad to see him, too, because I had a little problem. "What is it?" he asked, putting his large hand on my shoulder. "My dear Fortunato," I said, "I'm afraid I have been very stupid. The man who sells me wine said he had a rare barrel of Amontillado wine. I believed him, and I bought it from him. But now I'm not so sure that the wine is really Amontillado."
"What?" he said. "A cask of Amontillado at this time of year? An entire barrel? Impossible." "Yes, I was very stupid. I paid the wine man the full price he wanted, without asking you to taste the wine first. But I couldn't find you, and I was afraid he would sell the cask of Amontillado to someone else. So I bought it." "A cask of Amontillado?" Fortunato repeated. "Where is it?" I pretended I didn't hear his question. Instead, I told him I was going to visit our friend Lucrezi. "He will be able to tell me if the wine is really Amontillado," I said. Fortunato laughed in my face. "Lucrezi cannot tell Amontillado from vinegar." I smiled to myself and said, "But some people say that he is as good a judge of wine as you are." Fortunato grabbed my arm. "Take me to it," he said. "I'll taste the Amontillado for you." "But, my friend," I protested, "it is late. The wine is in my wine cellar, underneath the palace. Those rooms are very damp and cold, and the walls drip with water." "I don't care," he said. "I am the only person who can tell you if your wine man has cheated you. Lucrezi cannot."
Fortunato turned, and still holding me by the arm, pulled me down the street to my home. The building was empty. My servants were enjoying carnival.
I knew they would be gone all night. I took two large candles, lit them, and gave one to Fortunato. I started down the dark, twisting stairway with Fortunato close behind me. At the bottom of the stairs, the damp air wrapped itself around our bodies. "Where are we?" Fortunato asked. "I thought you said the cask of Amontillado was in your wine cellar." "It is," I said. "The wine cellar is just beyond these tombs where the dead of my family are kept." "Surely you are not afraid of walking through the tombs?" He turned and looked into my eyes. "Tombs?" he said. He began to cough. The silver bells on his cap jingled. "My poor friend," I said, "how long have you had that cough?" "It's nothing," he said. But he couldn't stop coughing. "Come," I said firmly, "we will go back upstairs. Your health is important. You are rich, respected, admired, and loved. You have a wife and children. Many people would miss you if you died. We will go back before you get seriously ill. I can go to Lucrezia for help with the wine." "No," he cried. "This cough is nothing. It will not kill me. I won't die from a cough." That is true," I said. "But you must be careful." He took my arm, and we began to walk through the cold, dark rooms. We went deeper and deeper into the cellar. Finally, we arrived in a small room. Bones were pushed high against one wall. A doorway in another wall opened to an even smaller room, about 1 meter wide and 2 meters high. Its walls were solid rock. "Here we are," I said. I hid the cask of Amontillado in there. I pointed to the smaller room. Fortunato lifted his candle and stepped into the tiny room. I immediately followed him. He stood stupidly staring at two iron handcuffs chained to a wall of the tiny room. I grabbed his arms and locked them into the metal handcuffs. It took only a moment. He was too surprised to fight me. I stepped outside the small room. "Where is the Amontillado?" he cried. "Ah, yes," I said, "the cask of Amontillado." I leaned over and began pushing aside the pile of bones against the wall. Under the bones was a basket of stone blocks, some cement, and a small shovel. I had hidden the materials there earlier. I began to fill the doorway of the tiny room with stones and cement. By the time I laid the first row of stones, Fortunato was no longer drunk. I heard him moaning inside the tiny room for 10 minutes. Then there was a long silence. I finished the second and third rows of stone blocks. As I began the fourth row, I heard Fortunato begin to shake the chains that held him to the wall. He was trying to pull them out of the granite wall. I smiled to myself and stopped working so that I could better enjoy listening to the noise. After a few minutes, he stopped. I finished the fifth, the sixth, and the seventh rows of stones. The wall I was building in the doorway was now almost up to my shoulders. Suddenly, loud screams burst from the throat of the chained man. For a moment, I worried. What if someone heard him? Then I placed my hand on the solid rock of the walls and felt safe. I looked into the tiny room, where he was still screaming, and I began to scream too. My screams grew louder than his, and he stopped. It was now almost midnight. I finished the 8th, the 9th, and the 10th rows. All that was left was a stone for the last hole in the wall. I was about to push it in when I heard a low laugh from behind the stones. The laugh made the hair on my head stand up. Then Fortunato spoke in a sad voice that no longer sounded like him. He said, "Well, you have played a good joke on me. We will laugh about it soon over a glass of that Amontillado. But isn't it getting late? My wife and my friends will be waiting for us. Let us go." "Yes," I replied, "let us go." I waited for him to say something else. I heard only my own breathing. "Fortunato," I called. No answer. I called again. "Fortunato." Still no answer. I hurried to put the last stone into the wall and put the cement around it. Then I pushed the pile of bones in front of the new wall I had built. That was 50 years ago. For half a century now, no one has touched those bones. May he rest in peace.
You have just heard the story, The Cask of Amontillado. It was written by Edgar Allan Poe and adapted for Special English by Donna DeSantis. Your storyteller was Larry West.
And that's our program for today. Listen again tomorrow to learn English through stories from around the world. I'm Dan Novak.